So for this second part, we're going to look at supervised learning, and this will be our main theme for the next few weeks. So I'm going to start now with a basic introduction, basic concepts of supervised learning. We'll look a bit at the difference between regression and classification, just very briefly, and then we're going to start with regression. The reason is that there are some concepts here that are easy to illustrate with this regression problem. And I'm going to start with a simple curve fitting. So we're not going to deal with any specific concrete problems, just something abstract, a set of points, and we're trying to adjust a curve. The reason for this, we're going to do these abstract type problems a lot in the beginning, is so that we can cover the basic concepts, the fundamental concepts, in very simple examples. So, basic idea of supervised learning. We have a set of labeled data. So all these axes are vectors of an arbitrary number of features. They can be, for instance, coordinates, they can be true-false values, they can be categories, something like that. Doesn't matter, but these are the descriptions of our examples. And for each example, so for example 1, we also have this value, epsilon, that we want to predict. So suppose that these are apartments, then we have a description of the apartment, number of rooms, if it has too much sun or too little sun, something like that. And then we have the value for the rent or for selling the apartment that we want to predict. And we assume that somewhere in the universe, there is this function, abstract function, that can relate this feature with what we want to predict. So this f function exists. We don't know what it is, but we assume that it exists. The goal of supervised learning is to find this approximate function g that takes in all the features of each example. So this is for all the examples, the capital X, so the matrix with all the vectors for all the examples. And also these parameters, this vector of parameters theta that we can adjust. And we can hopefully adjust these parameters so that our G of theta X is close to F. So also gives us the same relation that we want to figure out. So this is more formally the supervised learning problem. We have this set of labeled data, which has the right answer in all of those examples, and we want to use that to find an approximate function that for all the universe of X, knows that this X is all possible apartments, not just the apartments that we know, so all the universe of X, will give us the correct prediction. So this is supervised because since we are training, we are giving the experience to our learners, so the data for our learners, is this training set for which we know the right answer, all the examples we have the epsilon, we can, while we are training, check to see if our function is approximating the right thing or not. So we can supervise the training of our model. So ideally, and we'll start looking at that from next week onwards, we want to approximate this function f for all possible examples. Not just the examples we already know, but also the examples we haven't met before. Because that's the whole point. We don't want to predict what we already know, because that's pointless. What we want is something that works on new examples that we still don't know the right answer. So this would be the goal. We want our g function to approximate f for every possible example. However, we only have this training set. We only know the answers for this limited sample of the possible examples. And we're going to start by considering only this set. So the training set is the set of examples we use to adjust the parameters for our g, those theta values. Or more generally, if you want, the data that we use to select one hypothesis from our hypothesis class. And we can measure the error on this training set This is called the training error or the empirical error, because it's something we can actually measure. We can compare the prediction, the output of our function, with each label for each of the examples we know, and we can measure how wrong or right it is. If in Mitchell's book you find this as a sample error, because the training set is a sample that we obtained from all the possible examples. So this is actually not the most important measure that, or the only error measure that we'll consider, but for now we look at this, the training error that we are measuring while we are training our system. So for today we're going to focus only on the training set. We're going to ignore everything outside, and we want to try to predict the labels, the Ipsilon values on our training set. The performance is the error, it's a measure of how wrong our predictions are, and we want to improve that performance, so we want to minimize this error. And the data that we have is a set of points here, a set of labels, exactly. So this is basically the task, the experience, and the performance measure that we need to specify the machine learning problem. Now, there is this difference between classification and regression. Classification, if the Ipsilon value that we're trying to predict is discrete, and regression, if the value is continuous. This may appear to be a somewhat arbitrary distinction, just labeling things for the sake of labeling them, but actually there is a very fundamental difference. And we're going to start seeing this next week. Today we're going to look only at regression, but the idea is that when you're trying to approximate a continuous value, you want something that goes as close as possible to the right value, to approximate like that. And generally, this value is given by a set of points, so you can imagine some hyperplane or surface, or depending on the number of dimensions, but that is as close as possible to the points that you have. This is for a regression problem. For a classification problem, what you want is to split your data into different categories, and so the lines where you're going to cut should not be close to the points, but they should be as far as possible so you have a good separation. So it's actually a different thing. Nevertheless, you can do classification with regression, and that's what we're going to start next week. We're going to look at logistic regression, which is a form of regression that you use to classify. But we're going to do this gradually. We start with regression now, and then we're going to move on to classification. But this is just to get you the idea that there are similarities, but there are some important differences here. So let's start with regression. We have an example of linear regression, which is polynomial regression. This may appear a bit weird, because when you have a polynomial, you can have a lot of curves, but it's still a linear regression. And this is the main message for now, or one of the important messages, which is how you can use a linear model but still do something that is not merely a straight line. Because we're then going to use the same trick, so to speak, over and over again in many different cases. So let's start with a simple example. Our features are just one value, the x. What we want to predict is one value, one continuous value, which is its one. So our data is a set of points that have coordinates, x, y. And what we want is for each value of x, we find some way of predicting what is the value of y. So this is the regression here. And we're going to assume that our hypothesis space is the set of all straight lines. So we have the value that we want to predict, Ipsilon, is x multiplied by some parameter plus some other parameter. This gives us all possible straight lines that we may want to draw. Now the question is, which is the best line? We have these points here, and we have an infinite number of lines, so this is our hypothesis class. How do we find the best line for the point? So intuitively, we want to find the line that minimizes the error. But now we need to think about what this means. We need to assume something about our data and to try to figure out how we're going to measure this error. So this is an illustration of how statistics can help. Let us suppose that there is some function, somewhere in the universe, that f function, that gives us a y value given the x. But when we measure the y value to obtain our data, there may also be some error. So maybe we're measuring with the tapes and there is some error there in the measure. So in our data, or in general, when we sample the possible values, we can assume that there is some function of x plus a random error that occurs when we're measuring the epsilon value. Now we want to approximate this with our function g. We don't know what the f is, but we want to find an approximate function g, which in this case we are assuming is of this form, so it's a straight line. And these two values, theta, are this theta vector here with the parameter. So we want to adjust these parameters so that the straight line is as close as possible to our function. If we assume that this error is only applied to the epsilon value, not the x, and is normally distributed, so this is a normal distribution with an average, a mean value of zero, so it means that the error can go up or down for the epsilon with equal probability, and has this sigma standard deviation. So there is some distribution there with this form. And if we assume that we are approaching, with our g, we are approaching f, then we can get an idea for the probability of having those values. So of having the epsilon value for that x will be the normally distributed around the value that we are predicting, because the g is getting close to f, but then it can scatter around that with that error distribution. So this would be the probability of finding a value there. So if we have a set of points here, if we know that the joint probability, the probability of having this x with this y at the same time when we draw the value, is that conditional probability multiplied by the probability of having those x values, then we can write this. So the probability of having this set of values, of obtaining this set of values, is the product of all the individual probabilities, and so this product here is just that multiplication. Okay, so now let's relate the two of them. We can simplify things a bit, but the idea here, the concept, is that given some function, we can try to estimate this, and this gives us the probability, or the estimate of the probability of obtaining that sample of data if our g function is correct. Now, why are we thinking about this the other way around? Because we could think about the probability of our function being correct. But that's actually wrong, because our function being correct is not a random variable. It either is correct or it's not. So we cannot talk about the probability of getting the right function or the probability of the parameters, because those are not random variables that we're drawing. We are actually assigning them variables. What we can talk about is that if our data set, the training set, is a random sample of all possible points, then we obtain that with some probability. And if our estimate of the actual function f is correct, we can compute the probability of obtaining those points. So this, the probability of obtaining those points, assuming that our function is correct, is called the likelihood of our assumption. In this case, since what we're moving are the parameters, we can say it's the likelihood of the parameters. So here we have an idea of how we can find the best hypothesis. The best hypothesis is the one that gives us the maximum probability of obtaining the data we're actually observing. So this is the maximum likelihood hypothesis, the one that has the most likelihood. So this is the reasoning. If we know the function, we can compute the probability of the data. Note that if we don't know the function, we cannot compute the probability, right? So if I tell you that a coin is balanced, you can compute the probability of there being 10 heads and 5 tails or something like that. But if I don't tell you anything about the coin, you cannot compute the probability, because you don't know what the probability is. So if we assume, okay, this is our g with these values of theta, if that is true, then the probability of obtaining our data set, the data set that we have, we can estimate that. And we can do that for different values of g, and then of the theta, and then obtain the function that maximizes that probability. And that probability, the probability of the data given the parameters, is the likelihood of the parameters. Okay? So let's say the likelihood of our parameters given this data, with the data that we have, is the probability of obtaining the data under the assumption that the parameters are correct. So we can do it like this. We can take the logarithm here because we want the maximum value for the we want the theta value that maximizes the likelihood. And these are the same that maximize the logarithm of the likelihood because the maximum is at the same point. We can ignore this here because the probability of the x values does not depend on our function. You see here, we are assuming that epsilon is a function of g and this error, so we can estimate the probability of epsilon given some x, but we are not assuming, we are not making the distribution of probabilities of the x values dependent on the parameters. So, whatever parameters we put there, this term here will always remain constant. So since this is constant and we want to find the maximum, we can ignore it. And so we simplified it for this, and we can now replace here, in this conditional probability, the expression we have here. So this is the normal distribution. The normal distribution has this weird, ugly equation, but we have this, 1 over the sigma 2 pi multiplied by e raised to the power of this. And since we have the logarithm, we can shift this between from a multiplication to the sum and then take that e out. So we say that the logarithm of the likelihood is proportional to that logarithm, which comes down to this. That minus sign comes here, we change this to a sum, and we get this expression. Okay. So this is the expression for the finding the maximum likelihood of our theta. Actually, this is an approximation of the logarithm of the likelihood, but all these changes that we made keep the maximum value at the same point of theta, so we find the correct theta in this way. And since we want to maximize this, this is the same as minimizing the same expression with changing the sign. So basically, we are minimizing the quadratic error. So this appears a bit complex, but when we come to the end, we are just doing least mean squares. That is, we are minimizing the square of the difference between the actual value we want to predict and the value we are obtaining from our equation. So if we subtract for each point the value we are predicting from our equation and the target that we know, and we subtract the two and make that squared, if we add everything for all data points, we have the sum of the squares of the errors. Now, this is sometimes you're going to see this written as 1/2 this value and not the value. This is not, it makes no difference because we're going to try to find the theta values that minimize this function. And the reason for doing this is that when we compute the derivative to find the minimum, that 2 there will cut with these 2 and simplify the expression. So if you're looking at the book, you often will find this expression for the quadratic error and not this one, but it's the same thing because we want the values of theta that minimize the expression, and the value itself is not that value. So we're going to do least mean squares minimization to do this regression, to adjust, to find the best line for that data point. But the reason I show you this is that if I skip to this way and I will tell you we're going to minimize the quadratic error, that will seem okay, it seems reasonable, but it would look like something we are taking out of the hat and just making it up. It's not like that. This is the correct way of doing it if we assume this part here. If we assume that the epsilon is affected by some error, not the x, and if we assume that we are approximating the f and so on, and then we come down to the minimization of the quadratic error. But this comes from those assumptions. We could have other functions that we wanted to minimize if we assumed some things different. Okay, so all these target functions should have some reason for being like what they are, and we should understand that reason, because if you're going to apply this to a problem where the error is mostly on the x, you should know that this is not going to work very well, because you're assuming the error is on the value you're trying to predict. Okay. So how to find the best line? We have, as a function of the inclination of the line, this is one of the thetas and the position of the line, we can compute the total squared error based on all those points that we have. And we can imagine that this total square error, we can think of it as a surface, as a function of the two theta values that we have here. So we can imagine one of the theta values here, another here, and as we change them, we can get more error or less error depending on what the combination is. So now we need a numerical algorithm to solve this problem. We're not going to go into detail on that. That's outside the scope of the course. But it's important for you to understand at least the idea of how this works. So basically, these numerical optimization algorithms can start with some random points in one direction, and then find the minimum along that direction, and then change direction, find the minimum again, and change direction, and so on. So it's important that we have a surface that has continuous derivatives, so that we can find the direction to descend the surface, and that the surface is smooth enough and allows us to find the optimal point. If the surface is too complex or has discontinuities, or if the derivative is not continuous, then these algorithms will have problems and will not be able to find the correct solution. Okay, so we're not going to worry too much about the details of the algorithm that will be implemented in the toolbox, but it's important for you to understand that this is another big limitation in machine learning. It's not enough for you to write down the expression of what you want to optimize. You need something that can find the correct parameters. Okay? So this is the best line here, the one that minimizes the quadratic error, which is not a very good fit for this data. You can see that the points go up and then they go down, and they don't seem to be in a straight line. So if we try to fit them with a straight line, we don't get a very good fit. So we can, instead of doing a straight line, we could do curves. And that's what we're going to look now, how we can do that. Remember that we're doing linear optimization, but we want to do something that is not a straight line. We want to do a curve. What we can do here, and this actually, you can just do a polynomial curve, which is what we're going to do in practice, but I want to take a small detour to think about this in a different way. So let's say that we have here in two dimensions. We have x, we want to predict y, and we have a straight line. What we're going to do is we're going to do a linear fit again, so something that is straight, but we're going to do it in three dimensions. We're going to use a straight plane to fit our data. And to do that, we're going to add a new feature. Instead of having only one x and then predicting the y, we'll have two values for our features, two x values, x1 and x2, where x2 is simply a copy of the original value, and x1 is the square of that value. So now we expanded our data. Our x value is not only an axis, it is a plane here, and our data, or the feature, the x values themselves, form a curve in this plane, because we have one of them is a copy of the x and the other is squared, so we have this quadratic curve. And for each of these points, we have an epsilon value, so now we're working in 3D. We're trying to predict the epsilon value given these two x values. Our fit will be a linear model, again, which is, in this case, it has three theta values, theta 1 times x1, theta 2 times x2, plus theta 3. This is a plane that we can put in an inclination and up or down. And now, you can see it, the red is not showing very well here, but this is the plane that we used to fit. So this is the point going up and down, the epsilon value, but now the x is curved. So you have a curved line here, both going up and down and curving backwards. And when you fit the plane, you have something that has an inclination now. But this was a linear fit in that three-dimensional space that we obtained by transforming our data with the nonlinear transformation. If we now go back to the original space, we have to find where this plane is intersecting this side of the barrel here, which corresponds to the line we got from inserting that x squared term. And if we find this intersection and go back to the original one, we have this curve here. So this is actually a very complicated way of explaining a polynomial of degree 2 for fitting. But what you're seeing here is that even though this is a curved line here, in that higher dimensional space, it was a straight plane. So we did a nonlinear transformation to a higher dimension. We did a linear fit in that higher dimension, and then came back, and now we have a curve. And we can do this for 4 dimensions, 5 dimensions, whatever we want, and we can have a higher curve. In practice, what you can do, so this is an example for doing it using the libraries that we have. I have this data point in a CSV here. So I can, I'm going to use, you don't need to memorize this now if you don't know Python, but you're going to have the first tutorial is just about Python to understand how to use this. But I'm importing these libraries for dealing with the matrices and the vectors, and also plotting. I'm going to load the data from the CSV, telling it that the semicolon is the delimiter. Then I'm going to separate this, so the x values will be the first column of our matrix, the y values the second column, and now I do a polynomial fit of these x values to that those y values with a polynomial of degree 2. This will give me the three coefficients, those three thetas, and now I can create a set of 100 points just to draw the line and do the plot here. So the plot, I create a figure, I mark the data with red circles, and then I mark the polynomial values with a line, and then I save the file so I can show it here. So this you don't need to memorize this now, but you'll have a tutorial where you're going to do this. And this is fairly straightforward. That basically, fitting is just this line, the rest is just to do the plot and to show the result. So this is, we do this in practice by doing a polynomial fit, but it's important to keep in mind that we can conceive this as a transformation into a higher dimension, a linear regression, and then coming back. So basically, we can do everything with linear models if we change the data the right way. This will be especially important when we see support vector machines, because they have some neat tricks to do this implicitly. But it's a good idea to think about it in this way. So we fit curves by using straight or linear regression in higher dimensions. So now we can use this trick, and we can go, for example, to a polynomial of degree 3. We add this x cubed term. We now have 4 parameters, and we can do the same thing. We cannot now look at the graph of the linear plane, because now we have an hyperplane in 4 dimensions, and it's very hard to imagine that. But we do it the same way. We only increase the degree of the polynomial, and we have this fit. Or we can use the degree 5 polynomial, degree 15. And you notice that as we increase the degree of the polynomial, we get closer to the point. For instance, in here, with a degree of 3, we are still we have some error relative to the point. If we use degree 15, we can pass really straight on to the point, and the error is almost zero. So we could think of, okay, this is fine. We just increase the degree of the polynomial until the error is zero. But if you look here, this is a bit weird. If we have this data set, having a hypothesis that predicts this value here is quite strange. This is probably wrong. So it's not reasonable that by sampling our data we have these points, and then in real life they will have a value there here. So you see, this is a very fundamental problem in machine learning. We can reduce the training error a lot, as much as we want, by increasing the flexibility of our model, or the hypothesis we have, or basically by using hypothesis classes that can reach the data points better. However, when we do that, we start losing the ability to extrapolate to correctly to the points that are outside the trading point. So basically the same idea as of inductive bias. You can imagine that you have a hypothesis class that can fit anything perfectly, and then you lose completely the ability to extrapolate from your known data. So this is the trade-off that we have here. If we use something that is too simple, for instance a straight line here, we can get a lot of error on our data points and our predictions are not very good. But if we use something that is too flexible, so this case here, we can reduce a lot the error on the training set, but we can have predictions that are not very good too. So there's somewhere in between should be the right place to find our model. This is basically the problem of overfitting. Overfitting is what happens when we reduce the training error too much and now are losing the ability to extrapolate outside our training data. So this is what we're going to see next week. For today, just to sum up what we saw, so there is a basic difference between classification and regression. In regression we're trying to approximate the continuous value, in classification we're trying to distinguish, to separate the points into different categories. We're going to start looking at regression in a few lectures, and then you'll see that there is a relation between the two, but there is this also this fundamental difference. And we started looking here at linear regression. Linear regression doesn't mean that the final result is a line, but you can think of it conceptually as having all these different terms linearly separated, which consists of doing something straight, like a hyperplane that is straight, on a higher dimension, as long as the transformation going there and back is nonlinear. So we have all these squares and cubes and so on, which are nonlinear transformations of our data. But although this allows us to arbitrarily reduce the training error, we can make it as small as we want, at some point we are doing something wrong because now we are losing accuracy on the predictions outside the training set. So we'll see next week how we can solve that. For reading more about this, you can read chapter 6, chapter 1 of Bishop, and these sections of Alpaidan and Marco. Okay.